Hey, welcome. Hello. Thank you for clicking. My name's Kevin. I had a conversation with Claire Rae Randall the other day. I think I stumbled across Claire purely by algorithmic chance several months ago at this point. I happened across a video where she was doing she was doing a video podcast where she was discussing her latest book, which is called The War on Gender. I found her takes very interesting, nuanced, and refreshing. So I reached out, and we've been kind of private chatting on and off for several months at this point. Claire has an honors degree in philosophy and psychology from the University of Leeds. She also has a graduate diploma in art therapy. She's worked in psychiatry, mental health, and personal development, and has taught psychology and further education. From my conversation with Claire, I think further education is kind of an area of passion for her. The sheer breadth of, her interests kind of shine through in conversation. She doesn't disappoint at all. Claire transitioned, I think, in the mid to late 70s, so has been around in trans spaces to kind of witness the change over time. And is very concerned about the areas that she's seen it heading in recent years, which is one of the reasons that she wrote The War on Gender. We kind of had a generalized chat. I haven't actually read had a chance to read the book as yet. So this is just a general introductory kind of conversation. We kind of talk about a little bit about the things that are in her book, and we also talk about our mutual disappointment in some of the things that were left out of Helen Joyce's book, and it's just a general conversation from there. You can find all of the information that you need to locate Claire's blog or YouTube page, or how to follow her in the description below. I had a great time. I hope you enjoy too. Cheers.
Thanks ever so much, Kev, for all your patience.
No, you're fine. I've been as flittery as you, so it's worked out perfectly actually. Because I wasn't really, I only just finished reading the book like a week and a half ago. Because I ke it kept being, I was really, I don't know how into the social media thing you've been and for how long, but when Helen Joyce first popped up and announced her book and started doing the literary kind of interview circuit, but before the book was released, I was really, really impressed with her, and I was really hopeful. And then, as soon as the book got released, she seemed to change her tone
Interesting.
quite a lot. Like before the book got released, it was all about nuance and, being open-minded and being able to sort the wheat from the chaff. And then as soon as she released the book, it like the whole dynamic just changed. And
Interesting, yeah.
I bought the book and started kind of reading it, and I just couldn't get past the first chapter because it was just so disappointing. Like just the whole tone of, I started looking at your review and I was like, yeah, even the title is like it just screams confirmation bias from the beginning. So it's really taken me
Absolutely. Yeah.
a long time to get through. But I mean, there's stuff that I
I had
agree with.
such difficulty with it.
So I was very interested to see your take because I think we share a few things. Like I read Abigail Schreier's book first up, and
Oh, yeah.
that was beautiful. Like I really liked that
It's
book.
good, isn't it?
I didn't agree with everything, but she made it very clear that she was being as impartial as she possibly could, like probably too impartial in some places. And
Yes.
the juxtaposition between that and this is just night and day. So, yeah. I've been very interested to read your blogs about what your take on it is.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. I mean, I'm really so pleased that I'm getting some feedback because there is, I've just written a new blog that's kind of in the, hang on, just in the volume. I just, I've called it the Wall of Silence.
Oh, wow.
Because that's, that's what I'm experiencing. I've approached several well outlets that have made strong claims about this and offered them interviews, review copy of my book, The Guardian, The Conservative Woman in England. There's an independent blogger called John Waters who is quite into the kind of alternative media network, and they just don't even reply.
Oh,
I don't even
wow.
get an acknowledgement, not a single, I'd like to discuss this with you, please take my, I'd be happy to recommend you to my publisher for a review copy. Please let me know what you think about this. I have a nuanced view which doesn't agree with either side of the extremes. No, silence, complete silence.
Yeah,
Extraordinary,
I've had
really.
a very similar kind of trip. Well, obviously I'm not going to write a book or anything, but if you disagree with both sides, like I'm kind of more on the GC side. I kind of think this progressive politics, like there's definitely a problem, but if you have any criticism of the gender critical side, then you're a tra, like you're a trans rights activist, whether you are or not, you are. And if you are in any way critical of the trans stuff, then you're automatically a TERF. So you've kind of pissed both sides off, so there's no platform whatsoever for you to speak. And yet I kind of have found a group of trans people, even really young trans people that are in their early 20s, late teens, that are transitioned or transitioning, that actually we share, there's so much overlap. Like most of the transsexual or even a lot of the transgendered people that I'm interacting with are not really woke at all. They're not down for
Good, good.
all of either side. They have nuanced takes. So it's been very interesting because even most trans people that I know don't fall into either category. They're kind of somewhere in the middle. Like they're like, no, I'm not into this woke stuff, but like the GC stuff can be a bit too far in places as well because clearly there's something, clearly trans is kind of, it exists at the very
It
least.
exists
I
exactly,
think.
yeah. Well, it seems to have been, we seem to have quite recently gone into, like you mentioned about Helen Joyce, kind of ramping it up when her book came out and the promotion that she did after the early, outlet. And I think we've actually recently moved into another higher gear than even that. Because, for instance, Helen Joyce was into this thing. You might have seen a bit of her discussion with Jordan Peterson.
I saw the whole thing basically, apart from the Daily Wire bit.
I only watched a few bits of it because it was so extreme. I'm now, that I took a fairly soft view on Jordan Peterson because, I was writing the book back in the period 17, 18, 19, when he was open-minded about this. But when he was talking with Helen Joyce, I was very concerned about the they were taking the attitude now that even people who have benefited from transition and medical treatment are should be prevented from doing this. I don't know what they do with people like you and me, but they that it should be prevented from happening because it sets a bad example to other people who might or might not be, having some feelings about this. And I thought that is quite an extreme authoritarian view, really, isn't it? But now it seems to have gone to an even higher level than that. I don't know if you've seen the stuff that's been going around. There's a woman called Jennifer Bilek. Yeah, she's been around for a while. You know, people inhabit sort of various backwaters on the internet, and then you come across them, and suddenly you're, you know, in that stream, and it's complete full on abuse. There's no Helen Joyce will at least make the pretense of some discussion or debate. You know, she throws these odd words in, compassionate and so on and so forth, but. You know, Jennifer Billick is really not making any pretenses at all.
I actually saw your tweets. I think you were you tweeting with her the other day?
I was, yeah.
I almost tweeted at you going, no, walk away, like.
Yeah.
Well,
I've been through, go on.
She's been around for almost as long. She's been around for longer than I have. In this debate, but
oh, really?
I bumped into her very early on. There was another woman that was on YouTube they were kind of like twinsies almost, like they had a very similar view. And yeah, so I kind of bumped into that stuff early. I kind of wonder though, because the people that speak about there are a few things. And I bump into this regularly. So you and I talk about trans from our perspective and what it is to us.
Yes, I think I can see where you're going with this. Carry on, yeah.
And if we live in, like, we have our experiences of the being in the trans community and, you know, mingling with lots of other trans people over an extended period of time. So we kind of know what goes on behind, like, what goes on. But there are a whole heap of people that like Helen Joyce and you know, Billick and a lot of others that weren't, their attention wasn't really drawn to this until it was well past crazy. Like until, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
People with pink hair crying about pronouns and, you know, like just doing crazy things.
Yeah.
So for them, trans isn't really you and me, and sometimes they'll talk about nuance and compassion and kind of pay lip service or give us a nod, but they also talk about this subject so often, in and out every day, like pretty much every day. Like Helen Joyce went from working at The Economist, being an editor at The Economist, to working for Sex Matters. Yeah. This is now her bread and butter. And the more you talk about stuff, the more you speak in shorthand, and you kind of just assume that people understand where you're coming from. So I kind of think that maybe there's a little bit of miscommunication coming along with that as well, because I interact with a lot of, you know, GC, you know, women or feminists. And they will, when they're public facing, they will say things like, you know, similar to Helen Joyce, similar to the sorts of things that Helen Joyce says, and they agree with her. And then when they're talking to you in private, they, like, if you kind of broach the subject with them, they can kind of seem a bit shocked, as in, oh, no, I didn't mean you. Like, no. Like, transsexuals are a different thing altogether. It's almost like they kind of are assuming that we know that they're not talking about us, but even though it's not always really clear. So there's a lot of, and then there are other people that are saying exactly the same sorts of things that do mean us as well. So it's hard to, it can be very hard to know which is which until you start scratching.
I have found a few people on Twitter who, you know, have like, you know, turf and so on as their handles, and I have had one or two of them say that kind of thing to me. Oh no, well, you're all right, Claire, you know, we're not talking about you, you know. Or even one or two have kind of you know, tweeted me and said, you know, that I'm kind of you know, the kind of person that they should be kind of listening to. But at the same time, then they kind of often tend to bracket me with there are some kind of, I don't quite understand this position, but there are some moderately high profile trans women in Britain who are quite happy, you know, they pass as women, they've had all the treatment and everything, but they say, oh no, well, of course, you know, we're just men playing the, you know, the, what is it? The, the autogynephilia thing, and I think, well, no, I don't want to be associated with that either, you know. So it is very much, as you say, largely a matter of unfamiliarity with the terms and divisions. And as I say in my book, I mean, we need a better taxonomy of this.
Oh yeah,
really.
Yeah, like a better understanding. I was chatting to a trans woman here from Australia that was talking about, well, you know, like do the old, like, does AGP and HSTS, like, do those categories, are they as relevant as they used to be? Now there's ROGD as well. Like, as time has gone on and trans has kind of become more integrated in some ways into people's understanding of the world, like, have the categories expanded? Like, there is a lot of research that has, I'm always shocked by how much research there has been done, because I never really paid any attention to it, but there still hasn't really been enough. Like, I've been transitioned for 23 years this year, and I don't think I've ever even interacted with someone who was a part of a study, which is kind of really something about it.
And I would say that this is one of my really big criticisms of Helen Joyce's book, is that unless I blinked and missed it, she had no actual conversations with any trans women. I mean, she cherry picks the most absurd kind of examples of, you know, behavior to you know, use as examples of what we're all like. And it's quite absurd. I'm kind of left speechless with it, really. And I do think that it does go beyond, I think, what we were talking about a minute ago. I mean, there are a lot out there who have only become familiar with the subject in the last, you know, year or two, who you can excuse for not really understanding the taxonomy and the differences and the internal divisions, you know, that we're experiencing. But then there are people like Helen Joyce who, I mean, as I say in my blog, I mean, her whole presentation claims to be, this is definitive. This is definitive. You know, I'm telling you what you need to know. This is everything. And yet not a single direct interview that I could. It's very similar, actually, to Janice Raymond's book from the early 80s. Are you familiar with that?
I'm familiar with it. I've only heard, I kind of listened to a reading of the first chapter.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so funny, because I was kind of slightly terrified by that, by the existence of that, for some reason. I have no idea why.
But,
you know, I was kind of like, I don't want to know what's in it. Like, it must be monstrous.
Yeah,
you know, like, I'll just give it a wide berth, and it won't bother me, and I won't bother it, and we'll both be fine.
Yeah.
And then there was a feminist reading space on Twitter about it, and I jumped into it, and it just is like it's not even veiled confirmation bias. It's just blatant neon flashing lights. I don't like trans people. This is what they must be. Like, you know, I have decided before I explored anything, I had decided I didn't like them. So I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure that you don't like them as well. Like, I'm just going to present
everything bad.
And it's like, oh, okay, well, firstly, I was like, why did I think this book would be any different than this? I've been around for long enough, I should know by now.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was kind of shocking. I think
that's where the phrase morally mandated out of existence comes from.
Yeah, I think it may have been the first chapter and a half, I don't know, but it was enough to know that I didn't need to worry about anymore. Like, but yeah, I suppose there are things, like, I kind of agree with the rapid onset thing. Like, there's clearly something going on. I don't think it's the only thing that's happening. So there are bits in Helen Joyce, like, there are themes of Helen Joyce's book that I agree with, and I'm glad she wrote it. I am very disappointed in the way she went about it, because she's also made very clear since she published it, that she's also well aware of the Kate Millett and the influence that the feminists had moved like back all the way back to the 70s, 1970s, was published, how influential that book was in how we got here, and she just bypassed that completely. But I also think tactically she kind of had to do that if she wanted to gather any kind of audience. So I'm not sure I put them in the same category. Like Janice Raymond and Helen Joyce are. I think I would cut Helen Joyce a bit more slack than Janice Raymond. Is that
It's a
transsexual?
bit more subtle, I think, isn't it? It's a bit more subtle. I started out like you with high kind of expectations of it, particularly since the chap I borrowed the copy I read off said good things about it. And I think he was, looking at things like the ROGD and the ideology and the promotion and all that kind of stuff. And I don't think he was, kind of seeing under the bonnet of where this is going for us lot. And it's this whole kind of sidling away from the issue that the problem exists. That always they always say this, brief little thing about, oh well, there are a few people, but then it's right on, and then we don't exist. And I did one thing that a friend of mine said about Helen Joyce, not from having read the book, but from having seen some videos of her, which said that, and I would say this virtually from just a 5 second view of her expression when you watch her on a video, is that what she's projecting onto me is that she hates men. So anybody who she can categorize in that is, going to be conflated with that. And there's very you'll have noticed in my the blog pieces I've written, I've got plenty more to say, that her reasoning is extremely flimsy. I think it's what I would call poor and thin, because there are so many straw man arguments, there are so many conflations, there are so many missed out steps of reasoning and so forth. And I'm absolutely, frankly, astonished that people like Douglas Murray can write in such praise of her, because Douglas Murray is a very erudite kind of author on similar topics, but and Helen Joyce near the end of the book mentions about what she calls her crony beliefs. And I hadn't heard it put this way before, but I understand what it means, which is that people who espouse or describe, claim certain beliefs, put them out simply because they know that it will be popular, or they're playing to a particular audience, and it's not actually a seriously thought out belief. I mean, she may think it's seriously thought out, but I point out so many logical flaws in the things that she says, and flaws of evidence, and logical inconsistencies and fallacies and all this. And to me, this is, one point about this is that it indicates the kind of the poor level of intellectual rigor that is, being applied by many people, in who are supposedly, well placed in the public intellectual sphere, like, Jordan Peterson, Douglas Murray, so forth.
Yeah, they seem to be, and I can't say that I really blame them for it.
No, I know what you mean.
On one hand, because trans is such a unique, like people have forgotten, like I even in 2001, this was such an obscure, way out of the range kind of subject matter. It was so far off the mainstream map, and it has kind of. I was watching your. Some of your videos earlier where you're like, the precautionary principle really should be applied in if we're going to change stuff, it should be very cautiously and slowly. And that is absolutely the opposite of what's happened. Like, I kind of turned around in 2018 and was like, holy hell, where did this come from? Like 20 years of, like almost no trans anything whatsoever. And then suddenly just, the floodgates opened and there was a barrage of it. So I kind of appreciate where they're coming from in terms of, the damage that this ideology can inflict on younger generations is so severe. And is just so devastating that they kind of have to pull out all of the stops. Like they really need to stop this as quickly as possible, but they haven't necessarily investigated to the bottom of the. They've just found the first culprit and gone, oh, I can stop looking now. Like Kinsey money, we're done. They haven't really scratched too far to go, well, it's still going to exist. We can't ban this out of existence. Like these people. Couple of generation, like a generation and a half ago, existed outside of mainstream community in their own little, in their own little districts. Sorry, I just lost my thought. They're not going to go away because, like you can just they ban trans medicine outright. It just is going to create a black market. So they kind of have to do.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And integrate, like we kind of have to grapple. You're right in that we need to grapple with these, with this subject matter and figure out what we think about it and how we can make it as in not as dis as little disrupt things as little as possible, which also then throws responsibility back onto the trans community, in terms of. If you're going to do this, that's fine, but you also have a responsibility to, to try and fit in as well. Like,
Yeah, absolutely.
sorry, I almost
Yeah,
lost totally lost track there.
well, no, I know where you're going with that because I mean, now here in Leeds, Yorkshire, there is one of the core central ideological bases. Leeds University, I think the current name is the interdisciplinary something gender studies anyway. And I became aware of this. I mean, I kind of got caught up. I mean, I don't go into it that much in the book because it would kind of go into too much personal stuff. But I nearly got caught up in this kind of thing in the late 2000s. But it became rapidly clear to me that this was not, well, when I started going to kind of events that were there was where everybody was suddenly genderqueer, and I found myself being kind of out ostracized within the young lesbian, gay, and trans community around the period of 2010 because I was too normative. I just wanted to fit in society. I did not want to change the way that society viewed gender. This is the big thing, and this was what the agenda of the gender studies department is about, basically. And so obviously, this is where, sometime in that kind of, period of time, where there were people who were strongly pushing this because these ideas don't come out of nowhere without somebody encouraging them. I mean, it's very difficult to, pin it down. And I'm, people say there's some billionaire trans perverts doing this and stuff, and there may well be, but the way that they, again, we're back to this whole thing about, inadequate awareness of the boundaries and divisions within this.
Yeah, I kind of think, yeah, there are billionaire trans people giving money to causes. That's generally what rich people do. They give money to their causes. Did you see the Jamie Reed interview, the whistleblower from the Gender Center in America? Did a trigonometry episode that was really quite telling recently.
Oh, no, I'd be very interested to see that. I kind of went off trigonometry a bit because they seem to have an endless series of interviews with Helen Joyce and Jordan Peterson and other people just saying awful things about us. So I used to watch them quite a lot, but I went off. But and I keep trying to reach out to them, tweet them, everything, but you know, these places, they never publish their email address, or if they do, they must have a million emails, so it's very difficult to get through to them. I'd love to talk to them, but so
Jamie,
where are they at with this
Jamie is
Reed?
Really, really interesting, because I've kind of had this belief all along that whether there's an Oz behind the curtain pulling the strings of this or not, it kind of seems a bit far-fetched. And even if it is true, most people in the mainstream community are like, if you come at them with that, they're just going to call you crazy. They're going to think,
well, exactly,
absolutely
exactly.
Not. So tactically, even if it's true, tactically, it's a really bad play. Like, you're just going to push more people away than you win over. But Jamie Reed was a, you know, she's married to a trans guy. She's some kind of therapist or doctor or counselor that went to working with at-risk kids, and then she somehow found herself, she applied for and got a job working at a gender center in somewhere in America, and she was married to this trans guy, and she's like, excellent, you know, I'm going to be helping these kids, there's going to be processes, there's going to be safeguarding, and it's all going to be great, and I'm going to do wonderful progressive leftist, you know, queer things. It's all going to be fabulous. She got there, and it slowly dawned on her over time that there was no safeguarding, that there were no, you know, best practices. It was just a bit of all. It was just a bit of, if you say you're trans, no matter how old you are, and we're just going to let you do whatever you want, whether you know, like she was talking about, you know, parents would call up and say, I think my kid is trans, and start saying, you know, describing their children's behavior, and Jamie would be like, no, that's just normal gender nonconformity, like your kid's 13, you know, give them a wide berth, they'll probably grow out of it. The parents would be like, well, what am I looking for, just so that I know if my kid is really trans, what am I looking for? So she mistakenly told them in good faith, and then a month later that parent would be calling up, and everything that she told them would suddenly have manifested in the world. And the interview is really interesting, because it is very clear to me in that interview that here is someone who saw trans medicine from one, like the trans narrative, from an older, these people know what they're doing, they're really thinking about this before they rock up, they've spent years kind of agonizing, yes, no, maybe, yes, no, maybe, real, like this long drawn out process. That's kind of the framework that she thought she was entering. She realized that, like, she's going along with all of this, you know, like just pushing kids through. Mm. And it took her a long time to actually swap from the framework, like the framework of the thinking that she had, to realizing, you know, there's what she thought she was doing and what she was actually doing. And like, there was this, like, this horrific kind of, you know, realization of, oh my God, what are we doing? Like, this is not, we're hurting more kids than we're helping. We're not really checking to make sure there's no safeguards. And it was actually really interesting, because it kind of reinforced my view that I think that most people they're kind of coming at it from the framework, the old paradigm of, you know, these people have thought about this for a long time, and they've been gender nonconforming for a long time and dysphoric for a long time. Like, they kind of, like, I'm losing my words a little bit, but hopefully you know what I mean. Like, they're kind of coming at it from the old paradigm of, you know, these people have thought about this, and applying that to a new generation of people who are succumbing to peer pressure and wanting to be cool and wanting to be,
exactly.
Queer and break.
Because it was in the 20th.
Yeah.
I mean, in the 20th century, it was the complete opposite, wasn't it, in terms of peer pressure? You know, I mean, I myself, you know, I detransitioned after trying to transition at the age of 20, because I simply couldn't cope with it. The thought of what people might think and everything like that, even though I would have loved to have transitioned in an ideal world, it was just like that. I just couldn't cope with it, basically. And it probably wouldn't have been right for me, you know, to have just kind of, you know, gone ahead and done everything in the next year or two, because I was just too young and I was too immature. I didn't really understand my own feelings. I understood my gender dysphoria and I understood all about that. But, you know, I was also a person, and I had to kind of find out who I was in other respects and have a life, you know.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, it's kind of, they magnify something that might not be a problem at all. And I know what you're saying about, you know, where it comes from. I think to some extent it's a kind of mimetic thought virus that people who are like do-gooders, who think that they're doing the right thing. I mean, I have a relative who I've talked about this with, and I said, well, I'm very, very cautious about, you know, early transitions, and you know, even though I suffered terribly from a skin disorder, which cured literally overnight when I, you know, got male hormone blockers. But there was also, you know, other stuff going on as well. So, but this close relative, she said, well, you know, shouldn't they, I mean, she presumably knows very little about it other than the fact that a relative of hers, me, you know, is has gone through this, that, I would say, well, the trouble is that there is so much now, it's so much the other way around from what it was when I was young, that people are kind of falsely encouraged in it by almost like kind of like almost like focus group mentality. And she found it, you know, she was saying, oh, but wouldn't it be better for them? Well, there may be, I mean, I could have done with something that would have helped my skin, but the trouble is it's a slippery slope. The moment you start, you know, going down there for one person, then, you know, the triage and the assessment of young people is such a fraught subject that, and I thought, well, obviously she's not picked this up from me, you know, because I'm very cautious about this. I don't imagine, I mean, maybe she's been researching it on the internet, I don't know. But, I mean, she's certainly not gone to Mumsnet or any of the, you know, more popular anti-trans pages. So she's obviously just got it from general, maybe, I don't know, social media or something. And it's like, well, you know, it's you're fighting against the current when people who don't really know anything about it see a few posts from one side or the other, then their beliefs are convinced, and they won't even listen to somebody like you or I, you know, have had lifelong experience of it going back, you know, well past the millennium. I mean, it's very, very difficult to realize that even people who are reasonably intelligent and should be well informed actually have very little idea of what this is about. I mean, yesterday I posted a link for my book to something called GenSpect. Have you come across GenSpect? Yeah. Now, I don't really know much about them. The person who drew them to my attention said that she thought that her understanding was that they were wanting to, you know, kind of limit the number of transitions and support people who detransition because of, you know, this excessive kind of craziness at the moment. But I got the impression that they accepted, like Helen Joyce supposedly did, that there are people for whom it's right. You just need to have a close level of assessment, triage, and so forth. And then I got a post back from somebody saying, why are you posting stuff like that? This is all about detransition and stuff. And I thought, it's like these outlets, these blogs and these newspapers that I've written to offering, we're back to this thing where they're unable to distinguish the differences between different sub-demographics within this. Have I published the trans umbrella item yet on my blog?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm kind of a bit blunt in that, but I don't know what you thought of it.
I only skimmed it, to be honest. It's
interesting.
And I've bumped into a lot of older, like people that transitioned 2000, 2000, 2005, 2003, 2006, 2010, like people that have been around and they're adults when they transition, like they're well into their 20s or they transition, who are smart enough to realize that the transsexuals or trans people transitioning existed long before this ideology hit the airwaves. So therefore they're not the same thing. Like trans ideology or gender ideology, queer theory is not the same, is not what trans people used in the 60s, 70s, 80s or 90s as the basic fundamental theory that they transitioned under. It just wasn't like anywhere up to 2000, like somewhere after 2005, there's probably, you know, a slow stream of people that kind of believed it after that. But up until that point, like people dropped their eyes and laughed at the level of sheer nonsense. It was unbelievable. But there are, like, if there are a number of trans adults that are 10 plus years into transition that are so emotionally triggered by the horror that is unfolding before them on social media that they can't separate trans from ideology, then I kind of forgive people for that aren't trans and have had nothing to do with the trans, you know, trans anything or even gay anything for forever from not being able to do it. But there's also a practicality of we're kind of living in a populist era. Like the idea that there is some fundamental biological basis that, like, we don't really know why we transition exactly, like, or what causes dysphoria. But most people seem to be, even if they don't like it or they don't understand it, they kind of instinctively or intuitively understand that it is kind of a thing, like the gender dysphoria is real and it has, you know, it's not, you know, I don't have any trauma background whatsoever. Transition clearly worked for me. Like I'm sane, et cetera. Like I kind of think the idea that, which is why Jordan Peterson was a bit disappointing that, you know, that we're just going to be able to legislate everything out of existence all across the West. Is kind of a little naive, like.
Well, that's right. And of course, then you'll find that the rest of the world will continue to have normative gender values, and you'll get small little communities like the Indian Hijra and other people living in stealth and putting up with the lower standards of care and so on and so forth. But they'll be, you know, driven by extreme, conditions to do it all privately and off screen and so on and so forth, and it will be a great deal more troublesome for the actual real small population, even though in many ways children will be protected and so on and so forth. But it'd be kind of going back to like a almost like a kind of medieval or a fascist kind of, you know, policing of how people live their lives.
I'm kind of interacting with a lot of conservative, like America is a different kettle of fish because they're Christians and their right wing is somewhat more right than ours. Like Australia and England seem to be quite similar in a number of ways. No surprises there.
Mm-hmm.
But even dealing with like seriously conservative Christian type, you know, people that are anti-trans ideology, even a lot of them are well aware of the fact that the idea that that there's going to be enough votes in Australia or the UK to just ban it out, right? They seem to understand that putting things back under control is probably the best they can hope for at this point. Like the idea that there's going to be some kind of revolution whereby everything can just be taken back to zero.
Mm-hmm.
The cat is kind of out of the bag. We kind of have to to negotiate and deal with it is kind of the sense that I get from, like, because I have had a fair amount to do with, right wing people that are very concerned about kids and stuff like that. And the sense that I get from them and the things that they say to me straight up is, like they kind of just want things back under control. Like they want this out of the hands of kids. They want, their lives and their sports and their prisons back under control. They want sensible legislation. And apart from that, they kind of realize that the rest is probably not on the table anymore. Like,
Well, I hope not. I've just come across another book which was recommended to me, and it seems to be promising, but I shan't try to be too optimistic like I was with Helen Joyce. But it's a book by a woman called Hannah Barnes. It's only been out, I think it came out in February. You might have come across this. And just a minute, I've got a couple of quotes from an interview she did. Where are we? Oh, yeah, here we are. Oh, it's gone down. She says somewhere near the end of this, it says that yes, so Barnes was more cautious. During our conversation, she stressed that there are more unknowns than knowns. So has GIDS helped some people? As far as we know, yes, it has. I've spoken to those people, so that's good. She said, has it harmed people? Yes, it has, and I've spoken to some of those people. So that looks to me like somebody who is trying to understand the situation, but realizes that it's kind of gone a bit crazy. I mean, I think it's, I think there are kind of, like you say, it's a complicated kind of melange of different influences going all the way back to kind of French postmodernist ideology and Judith Butler and gradual kind of social kind of ideological movements that various people have kind of added to and concocted and things, and they've managed to, it's just kind of like people egging each other on, I think, to a large extent. And I'm so glad to see something like Hannah Barnes, not just completely saying that the Tavistock Institute was, an absolute evil, tool of, people who want to do these awful things to children. To some extent, these people kind of just got out of control, I think, didn't they? And they're kind of consumed in their own echo chamber without realizing that they've kind of gone over the edge.
And I think that there's a case to be made that a lot of the people that are pushing back against the Tavistock have also found themselves caught in a, an echo chamber of people that agree with them that is a little bit anti-reality as
Yes.
well. But yeah, so did you want to outline anything else about, because I'm actually really interested in kind of the nitty-gritty of the, like, your critique of the trans book. Was there anything that you wanted to get into specifically about that, or just
Well,
in general?
I think, I'm kind of thinking various different points kind of pop to the front of my mind, because it, but I mean, the overall thing is that the whole book seems to be one endless straw man conflation. And also I find her very, there's some very condescending things, because towards the end of the book, she says, she, kind of admitting about trans women who pass, she kind of wags her finger at us and says, oh, well, we may not be able to stop you from using women's toilets, and you might get away with it, but really you shouldn't, naughty people. And it's a complete failure to look at what anything else anybody has, to say about it. It's like a monograph, it's just her own particular thing. I'll just look and see if there's anything that comes up. Well, yes, I would like to say, I mean, to go back to the causes of this. Now, she's very she's very, she does, she basically doesn't address the issue of what causes this. And as you've said, you know, it's still under review and research and all that. But she basically completely dismisses that there might be organic underlying causes to this in development. And I think that, well, there's a case that has kind of gained a certain amount of notoriety that perhaps we should talk about, which I think she misrepresents completely. Now, you're probably familiar with the David Reimer case.
Yep.
Yeah. And obviously, that's a complete tragedy. And Dr. Money was really handled it most unethically. And Dr. Milton Diamond is correct, I believe, to call it the most unethical, you know, scientific experiment in history. And it's absolutely awful. Now, having got that out of the way, there's a very sneaky, I mean, I'm this is why I say that I think Helen Joyce is so poor on her reasoning. I simply cannot believe that she doesn't see the inconsistencies in some of the things she says, because she says that David Reimer, believing he was a boy, did not make him a boy. Well, I mean, clearly, you know, that's a kind of truistic statement, isn't it? But he was brought up as a girl. He had apparently external female, you know, genital morphology. He was, in fact, Dr. Money went to great lengths to try and persuade him he was a girl, even when, you know, there was nothing else going on, when he was just a young child. So clearly, David Reimer had unease about his apparent sex or gender, and he realized that he was really a boy, and unfortunately he had been mutilated shortly after birth and so on and so forth. Now, Helen Joyce simply says, well, his feeling or believing that he was a boy did not make him a boy. And then she moves on as if that is the case, as if that is the argument that Dr. Milton Diamond, who wrote this definitive paper about the case, was claiming. Of course, he's not claiming that David Reimer was magically, you know, became a boy because he believed it. David Reimer knew he was a boy because there were obviously neurological things going on inside his head, which, you know, caused him to have that belief.
Yeah.
And yet she brushes this case off, which I think is the most demonstrative of much of the, you know, kind of research that's been done into this. Because if you turn it round the other way, then at least it allows the logical possibility that people who felt the same way as David Reimer did might feel that for different reasons, but from the same cause, if you see the difference, what I'm saying there.
Yeah. I do see what you meant. When I was listening to the book, and she kind of, I kind of do this thing where it's like something doesn't sit right with me. I'm like, I can see what you're saying, but there's something wrong about that. Like, it took me, like, and I kind of was thinking other things at the same time. So it took me a little while to come back and go, hold on, you're kind of pretending that point reinforces your argument, but actually it kind of doesn't. Like, you know, he's everything inside him, despite everything external and everything he's being told, is telling him he's a boy. His behavior, like all of his internal messages, is saying he's male, despite all of, you know, the rest of the world telling him, no, you're not. Like, the fact that they were lying to him is kind of a little bit irrelevant. It kind of, it's not the slam dunk that she thinks it, or that she
kind of thinks it is. No. And also, it's very interesting. Some of these arguments she makes. Now, I'm going to have to reread. There's a paragraph. There's a chapter later in the book, in which she, I think she gets very confused about how much sexual biology contributes to the identity of the whole person, because on the one hand, she's kind of arguing that I mean, perhaps I'm slightly paraphrasing her, but she kind of takes the, you know, oh, it's kind of oppressive for women to have to give birth, and this shouldn't be an important part of their identity of women and stuff like that. And at the same time, she's very, very closely and tightly wedded to the idea that, you know, we are our reproductive biology and no more. So it seems to me it's a very kind of, she hasn't properly thought out that argument, because I think she's kind of contradicting herself. You know, because as you obviously know, I mean, my view is that, you know, your nervous system and your brain, like David Reimer, is more important than, you know, your external morphology or even your reproductive capacity, you know.
Yeah, I think you're right. I had some questions as to whether, like, I was a little bit unclear on your blog whether you think, like the brain sex thing actually makes your biology irrelevant. Sorry, that's a bad way to put it. Whether
probably going too far, but go on, yeah.
Yeah, I was like, no, she's not saying that. She's saying, I kind of think that, because I've had this conversation, people talk about, do you have a boy brain in a girl body? And I'm like, no, I don't think so. I think I have a girl body and a girl brain that is somehow underdeveloped or tilted towards masculinity in a way that this is comfortable for me, because really when you think about it, this should not, like, transition and detransition has kind of proved this in many ways as well, like transitioning and having the secondary sex characteristics and the social stepping into the social sex role of the opposite sex should be the most uncomfortable thing, unnatural thing, you know, because your biology is written in your DNA down to every bit of your DNA has your sex encoded in it. So it should be the most uncomfortable thing. Like, this should be the most abnormal, unnatural feeling thing that anyone could possibly do. Yet somehow it provides great relief. So clearly there's something going on, which is kind
well,
of...
Well, I think... Yeah. So what I found myself saying now about this, because... it's a kind of idea that came up while I was looking into the research, is that I don't think anything is absolutely definitive about this. However, there are lots of things that are indicative. In other words, there, like you say, that's a good word. I hope you don't mind if I use it in future. Tilted. Yeah, tilted. Tilted in that direction. And you have to find the balance with that tilt. That's a good term, because balance and tilt kind of, you know, kind of relate, you know, relate to each other. And I mean, I remember as a teenager and as a young adult often saying that I didn't know how to be myself. I just didn't know how to be myself. I wasn't sure what myself was, because in a sense, I was trying to put myself, which had some kind of, you know, inner messaging, as you put it, that wanted to be a certain way, trying to be, put that in a form and an expression, which I just really didn't have the capacity for. And I think there is also an interactive thing that goes on, whereby I think that I think people have an instinctive reaction. And I think that a lot of, you know, trans people, they're just respected because they provoke that instinctive reaction that you're a guy, you know, I look at you, you're a guy, you look like a guy, you behave like a guy, you talk like a guy, you know, there may be complicated things going on underneath the skin, but it's the instinctive response that's how I perceive you. And I can understand why people sometimes get triggered and freak out when they find out that someone who passes actually is, you know, transsexual and changed and stuff. But I think they need to get past the what in that case is like a kind of indoctrinated kind of thing, you know, that they've probably heard, you know, all these trannies, you know, when actually it's kind of overthinking it, you know, that I mean, I've had several women friends who have said nice things to me about how I look or whatever. And then at a later stage, they found out I've disclosed to them because they said something about it. And I thought, I can't bottle this up any longer. And then they just freak out because I imagine it's something like cognitive dissonance, whereby their experience, their perception of me is telling them one thing. They've always thought that thing. That's how they perceive me. It's no problem. And then suddenly they find out something that intellectually, in a kind of left brain way, seems to contradict that, or at least it's kind of paradoxical. So they need to kind of get beyond the difficulty that presents to them. But then if they're willing to just recognize that they had this, you know, instinctive kind of, you know, gut response to start with, then that they shouldn't overthink it like this. But on the other hand, I've also had one or two who have, I haven't actually come out to, I have a very, very good friend. And we had a conversation once and it came up and I thought, oh dear, not mention anything about this. Just see how this turns out. Anyway, a few weeks later, she saw one of my video blogs. And next time I saw her, she didn't say anything until about later in the evening. And then she said, by the way, she said, I saw that video blog of yours. She said, and it completely changed my whole way of thinking about this. That was really, really, that was absolutely wonderful. She's a really good person and I'm really, really glad to have, you know, met her. And I think that there are occasions like that in which you can, I mean, you see these trans rights activists freaking out and having tantrums on the floor and punching people and things like this. And I think it's a much more productive strategy to just wait your time and let people find out, because when people are finding out about things that are unfamiliar with them, then really it's like, I did a little bit of teaching when I was younger. And one of the main things, and also being an art therapist, it's clear to me that particularly when people are coming across difficult ideas or perceptions, that they need to do it in their own time and take it gently. And this is actually what, you know, Hannah Barnes, actually her book, the title of her book is
Time to Think,
I think it's something like that, which I think is kind of good, because that's almost exactly what Jan Morris wrote to me when I exchanged messages with her in 1974. She said, take your time. And, you know, I kind of rushed into it 6 months later, but then eventually, you know, it did work out because I took my time and worked it out in my head and, you know, understood how to do it. And I think it's, there's so much motivation going out there, people who just don't really understand where they fit into society. And this is just a sudden quick fix solution that really has no kind of real relation to the problems.
Yeah, there's a lot of messaging about, you know, that this will fix your problems and that you'll be a different person. And it's like, no, you take yourself everywhere. Everywhere you go, there you are. Like, you take your problems with you. And I absolutely believe, like, other comorbidities need to be sorted out before you start transitioning. But there is also I know a few people, and I was like this as well. I was kind of on and off antidepressants and had depressive episodes right up until the point that I transitioned, and then I started transitioning and I never had another depressive episode again. Like, when I got divorced, I had a massive depressive episode, but you kind of so there's a lot of bad faith assumption about, you know, conspiratorial theories and people, you know, rushing youth on to transition and ignoring comorbidities, not really realizing there's also within the community a long history of people having mental health issues, not massive, you know, like borderline personality level stuff, but you know, like having mild to moderate mental health issues that are then cured by transition, that a lot of these therapists and endocrinologists and people that are within the trans community have seen play out over and over and over and over and over again. So then when the demographic kind of suddenly starts to shift after 2010, 2015, and you have like a new generation of people that have more mental health comorbidities than any generation has come before them, and less resilience. Perhaps the doctors aren't, you know, the medical teams and the gender teams aren't quite clued up enough. And I think they probably should be well aware of that by now. But, you know, like, this is a complex issue, and there are a lot of multi-factor things happening simultaneously. And there are people on the trans side that want to oversimplify and just go, if you say you're trans, you're trans. And then there are a lot of people on the other side that are trying to oversimplify and saying there's no such thing as trans because it's just all nonsense. I don't make any sense of it, heads or tails. Like, you know, like it kind of is. Yeah.
Well, I was one of the people I've contacted in through Twitter is somebody, I think it's Katie Montgomery. I don't know if you've come across her. Anyway, she's a trans rights activist. She appears to have made quite a good successful transition medically. And yet she seems to be taking a very strong view, because when I, you know, contacted her, I said, oh, you seem to have a high profile, you know, would you like to, you know, could I get to know you a bit better? Maybe have a chat on Zoom or something, you know, find out a bit more about this, have a discussion, see where you're coming from and stuff. And she just kind of like, oh, I'm pretty TRA, you know, and, you know, and then I go back and look at her stream, you know, and it's just an endless series of, as you say, you know, respect people when they say they're trans and all this stuff without any, and without any form of assessment or investigation or challenge at all. And I find it very difficult to understand why people like that. And there's another one, who I've met personally at the launch of that book on self-ID that I've did a video blog about. And again, it's somebody, oh, I can't remember her name. She you know, she seems to have made a reasonably good transition, passes reasonably well, you know, but yet she's absolute hardcore gender ideologue and, you know, freaked out when I tried to suggest to her that, you know, the normal situation, of course, was, you know, male and female and everything, but that, you know, that there are variations and that we need to find out the best way to express these variations within, you know, the context of society. And she just completely freaked out at the thought that there might be, you know, kind of abstract, you know, evolutionary categories that shouldn't be deconstructed, you know, to her, it would just deconstruct. So she's not even the same as Katie Montgomery. Katie Montgomery is, I mean, extreme trans rights, anybody is trans. You know, then this other one is like, you know, well, we can't deconstruct it. And this is this kind of constellation of lots of different kind of contradictory ideas coming from this trans rights area that's not, I don't think that's actually consistent at all, a lot of it.
Well, no, when you follow them halfway down the rabbit hole, they start to fall apart. Like once you start questioning, like once you question any of it, like it all starts to kind of pick apart, which is like, I kind of realized that pretty early on because, you know, like my counselor was like, you know, you've always been a man kind of stuff. And I kind of did that thing where I was like, yeah, that, you know, like that you're telling me what you think I want to hear. I'm not sure that is what I want to hear. And then, you know, like within a couple of days, it kind of just didn't sit very well with me. And then I was like, hold on a minute. I still have like a uterus. Like that's not real. Like I'm going to have to find another way to make sense of this because that ain't it. Like it just isn't it. Like, yeah. So there are a lot of people that a lot of these ideas are kind of unquestionable, because as soon as you start to pick them apart, and instead of going, okay, well, maybe that's, they seem to do this thing where it's like, they kind of put all of their chips on that bet rather than going, look, this exists, like, it's clearly something we, you know, we're going to have to fiddle around until we figure out exactly what it is, because we just frankly don't really know. They kind of put all of their chips on this is it, and then if that's not it, then the whole bet crumbles and they lose the house, rather than, you know, kind of going, well, it might be this, it might be that, let's kind of explore and figure out what's going on here, with the assumption that it absolutely exists, because there are quite a number of us now, like, and there have been for quite some time. I kind of also think, like, the number, like, it's kind of like the Titanic iceberg thing. There's only so much sticking out of the water, and then there's like the rest of it under the water. Like, I don't really think that people are coming into this debate now realizing how many trans people are just out quietly living their lives in the suburbs, in society, doing their bit. Like there's a fair few of us. Like, there's a lot more than people kind of realize. Because I kind of keep bumping into people that are you know, parents that have ROGD kids, or, you know, like the parents that are freaking out a bit, and they kind of meet you and kind of have this whole moment of, oh my God, like, you're like just like a normal person, like, you're actually sane. What the fuck's going on with that? Like, and it's like, you know, I'm not even unusual. Like, there are heaps and heaps of us just like me, but because we kind of disappear, and, like, I don't know about you, but a lot of the trans people that I transitioned with, or that I have been friends with over the years, like, I've called a few of them or messaged a few of them and gone, hey, have you seen this woke stuff? And most of them have no idea that the politics have changed to what they have. Like, they just have no concept whatsoever, that
what, because they're kind of out of the scene, out of touch with what's going on. They don't pay attention, and it's passed them by, but it's there.
One friend was like, they keep talking about trans people like there are no older trans people, that, you know, that all these blue-haired people are the only trans people. They are. Another one was like talking about, you know, TERFs, like they're just the typical toilet, you know, feminists that pop up every 10 or so years. Like, it's just the garden variety, you know. We saw it a decade ago, we'll see it in a decade again. Like, it's, there's no difference. And I was like, no, dude, you need to check this out. Like, and I kind of sent him a few licks, and I'm not sure he actually believes me as yet, that this is what's actually happening. Like, so, you know, I kind of think that there's a lot of people.
That's a very interesting perspective, because obviously, you know, you and I see the front line on Twitter, and it's appalling. There's a point you're saying about one thing that I'd like to get back to about, you know, you're saying, we don't understand this. And I'm saying, you know, it's not definitive, but there's kind of indicative things and stuff. And it's a bit kind of fringe, perhaps, but I'm very much into the concept of cymatics. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's the science of resonance. And it's kind of on the edge of, you know, scientific thought. It's the science of how standing wave patterns can be created. Like, the way it was discovered was by having a musician, scientist, about 200 years ago, found that if you bowed a metal plate that had sand on it, that depending on the frequency, you could get different patterns to be created, where the vibrations cause the sand to settle. And in fact, you might be familiar with certain kind of Indian or Buddhist images called, I think they're called yantras, which have these kind of interlocking triangles and shapes. And you can actually generate some of these patterns it's a big kind of question as to how it is that the Buddhists were able to create these patterns. Presumably they had some kind of cymatic experimental thing. But anyway, so what I'm trying to suggest about this is that, of course, Nikola Tesla probably would have been into this because, you know, everything has kind of internal resonances and vibrations. And this brings me back to David Reimer and what you said about, you know, what's going on inside. And of course, the brain has, you know, electroencephalographic patterns. And there's even been some work indicating that trans people have brain patterns associated with the opposite sex. So yeah. That, I mean, it's quite a kind of out there edge kind of scientific thing. But I just like kind of add it there to the mix, really, that there are obviously so many different things. There's you know, hormonal development, you know, different structures in the brain developing and, you know, possible, you know, early social influences, although it's something I think more internal, you know. I think we might see more in terms of cymatics, although I kind of saw a look of perplexment on your face because
yeah, I'm really not a science person. Yeah. I think I understand.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to say what we do, it's part of that instinctual response, isn't it? You know, there's been work like, you know, curly and photography and, you know, how people give off certain subtle, you know, vibrations, pheromones, all sorts of things that cause people to feel differently about one person as opposed to another. And it's a very kind of complex and subtle, you know, thing. But I think this is, you know, part of the mix anyway, although it's perhaps a little bit.
Yeah, you know, like I kind of.
A difficult idea.
Yeah, I kind of came out this way. Like I've always been, you know, like I look different and I'm a little bit different because the hormones affect how you think and how your emotional regulation happens. But, you know, like I was just always this person. So I kind of tend to lean towards, you know, whether it be, you know, my mother actually thought I was like intersexed for a fair while, like even though. It,
oh, really? That's interesting.
There's
yeah.
There's no evidence that that's actually the case, but she, you know, kind of told me 10 years after I transitioned that that's what she assumed when I was a kid, which kind of makes sense why she let me do the things she let me do when I was a kid. But, you know, there's no evidence of that. But yeah, you know, I kind of think, you know, and it's not that uncommon a story amongst trans guys that I have known of. I didn't ever really feel like I was never actually cognitively or consciously aware of it. People would tell me that I should have been born a boy, you know, like post puberty and stuff like that. You know, it was just
that's very interesting to see, hear things like that.
You may as well tell me that I'm going to land on Mars. Like, that's completely irrelevant to everything. So, you know, why bother? So I kind of tend to agree with you. I kind of think that there is some kind of hormonal, internal, biological driver as to why it makes why people lean this way. But I've also, like, my best friend when I was in year 7 and 8 in high school, like, so the beginning of high school was also, you know, like a very, like, she was more masculine than I am, like, than I was. But she was probably, like, she kind of went into the army, into the MP, like, military police kind of army. She had a very strict family structure. Her father was a policeman. So she was, like, a little bit less, like, open-minded than I am. And she seems to have found her own way, even though she was probably more masculine than me. You know, it's not like the typical, oh, you know, I was a tomboy kind of stuff. It was like, no, that on steroids. People used to say things like, oh, you know, they would call me a tomboy well into my 20s, and it was a very, you know, oh, you know, like a different, it was a different level of tone altogether. It was very knowing, like it was like that plus. So I kind of, you know, like there are a lot of, I think there are people that kind of tilt this way or have those biological influences that have different personality traits that where, you know, they kind of deal with their dysphoria or their incongruence in a different way and lead happy lives
Yes.
in different
Yeah.
ways,
Yeah.
which is.
I do kind of, I mean, I do, you know, I do kind of, in some way, kind of respect people who can manage that, you know. But it's just so impossible to be completely inside somebody else's head to I really understand what their level of dysphoria was, or how much it's just a kind of you know, a kind of social tendency or something like that, you know. And it's definitely a case that you can't interpret people, and if somebody makes a choice, you have to, you know, kind of go with it. I mean, I thinking back to you, we were talking about detransitioning a minute ago, and you might have been thinking about that young chap who's, I feel he's rather being taken advantage of, actually. As you know, the one who's, he's
Richie.
been on Blair White, and I can't
Sure.
remember what his name is. Is it Jules? Maybe it's something else anyway, but I think you know who I mean. And I just kind of find myself wondering how it is that people get as far down the line as, you know, to have all, have, you know, to, you know, to have surgery, and then say that it was wrong, you know, that it was a mistake and everything like that. It kind of baffles me how confused people can be to have got that far. It's you know, obviously one feels very sorry for him that, you know, he made this kind of mistake, but I mean, the lack of, you know, caution and care from the medical people is staggering.
Yeah, I think that there are a number of things happening there. I like it's absolutely horrific. That goes absolutely without saying. The level of safeguarding specifically for those sorts of permanent, there's no turning back type surgeries has, people aren't taking it as the doctors aren't taking don't let me say this the right way. The doctors don't seem to be as cautious about this as they used to be. I also think that there is a sense now, like we're also talking about like a couple of generations later, where people kind of seem to have this expectation that everybody else is going to take responsibility for their choices. So they kind of, look into it a little bit less like,
Interesting.
I know a couple of trans women who are young trans women who are looking into surgeries, and they're spending like basically years looking into all the different methods, weighing the pros and cons, talking to different surgeons, like not going like they well they also have more disagreeable personalities and are somewhat more resilient as well as individuals. So they're kind of taking a lot more, there's a lot more caution on their behalf. They seem to be taking more responsibility for the choices that they're going to make. They're taking it upon themselves to be, to do the research themselves rather than expecting the doctors to come to them with this, with all of the dangers and the risks like that, which is something that I like with the older trans women that I know that have had genital surgery, like that's very reminiscent of what they did as well. Like they would talk about all the ins and outs and all the details and, talk to each other about this surgeon and that surgeon and this technique and that, like they would go through all of the risks and the complications with each other as well. Like, I think that there are a number of dynamics that are happening. I think the safeguarding being lowered by the doctors is definitely one factor, and it is, like it's the one of the most massive factors. But I think there's a lot of generational stuff as well, like people, kind of being told everything can kind of, I don't know, there's just less resilient less resilience building in people's, it seems to be in people's upbringings now as well. Like there's, that Jonathan hates stuff
Well, I
is.
think we have to, the internet has really changed a lot of this, hasn't it? I think that whereby people can have, online avatars where they, have a, opposite sex gender identity, and it doesn't actually require doing anything, and then you can kind of live in a kind of fantasy world that people encouraging you and everything, and then you're kind of almost just kind of herded down a kind of social peer group kind of acceptance level without the kind of self-examination that really should be an essential part of the whole thing.
Like that was one of the most major factors when I transitioned. Like I transitioned in 2001, which you would think being a trans guy, so knowing that I would, I kind of knew that I would look like this more or less. I knew I would pass completely, because I'm also, 5 foot 8, so
Oh, good, yeah.
tall enough, kind of, still short but tall enough. And even with those factors working for me, there was still a lot of fear about, how I would be accepted externally, socially. Like that was, this was like the worst thing you could possibly do. Like in terms of social acceptance, it was like, if you were left alone, that was a plus.
Oh,
Whereas now it's the opposite. Like there's a celebration everywhere you go. It's like, is it really any wonder that people aren't thinking this through when you have, they are going to get more praise for making a snap decision and going through with it than they would be not doing it. Like,
Well, this Hannah Barnes has said that she's been called transphobic for writing about the failure to safeguard in the Tavistock clinic. I mean, it's quite extraordinary, the just the unwillingness to look any further than an immediate kind of amygdala trigger reaction. It's not thought through at all. By and then again, this kind of just reinforces the whole kind of peer group, over over acceptance,
I'm looking for, I've seen a few of Hannah's interviews, and I'm pretty impressed so far. She's actually at the BBC, which is kind of impressive.
Yes.
She's makes it even more
Well,
impressive.
yes.
Everything
Exactly.
says that she's
Exactly.
saying. I kind of think it's kind of unfortunate because people see things from the perspective, like from their own perspective only. So you've got these people who transitioned either young or as young teenagers or as early 20s that went through, like I didn't have to do any therapy whatsoever. Like I got a green light, I went straight through, it was already informed consent in Sydney when I went through in 2001. So it wasn't until I got to chest surgery that I actually had to go and see a proper psychiatrist or a psychologist to get signed off. But because, which is horrific, but at the same time, the social stigma kind of was police do was still doing a lot of that police work. So, but you have people now who don't really understand the history, who made the right decision for them, have made it work, who only see it from their perspective. They're like, listen, if we put more safeguarding in place, then you're going to make it harder for the people that this will work for, which is unacceptable, instead of going, hey, well, I like it would probably be beneficial for me to slow it down a little bit, to build a bit of resilience, to do a bit more therapy so that I know exactly what I'm doing as I'm doing it. I've got a bit more time to think, and we get to safeguard the people who, really shouldn't
Exactly.
walk this path. They're kind of not thinking about it in that terms. It's all oppressor oppressed, power dynamics. Like it's very, it's so confused. It's I'm kind of with you on that front. It's like it's kind of shocking that people are not thinking about, you know, the safeguards aren't there for the people that it works for so much as it is for, you know, the safeguards are there for the people this is not going to work for, because yeah, you know, knee surgery has a higher regret rate apparently, but the difference between knee surgery and this is pretty extreme. Like they're not exactly
Yes. Yeah.
the same category of regret.
No, 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 no.
So it's kind of, yeah, you know, it's a weird and interesting situation across the board.
Yeah, it sure is.
Was there anything else you wanted to say before we can do this again if you're up for it?
Oh yes, absolutely. We're very happy
I'm
to,
totally up
because
for it. We can kind of, you know, organize a bit more.
yes, yeah, no, I'd love to do it again. It's kind of well, you know, it's kind of like freeform jazz, isn't it, really? You know, kind of doing a something like this.
Yeah, it works for a while.
You know, not quite sure what you're going to get into when you start it, and then you know, 5 minutes after you finish, you think, oh, there was that lick I wanted to play, you know. But it's important to keep on these conversations, because there will be we'll be returning to some of these topics that we've raised, because I think, as I've said, we're entering a new phase now where it's really, really ramping up. And they do want to, there are people now who are getting a lot of traction, unfortunately, you know, talking about eradicating us, basically, you know, as if we are, you know, cockroaches or something. I mean, it's really pretty kind of scary kind of projection that they're putting on us, basically.
Yeah, they're fine. I kind of, because I do a lot of Twitter and Twitter spaces in my spare time when I'm not at work. So I'm kind of engaged in this debate on a daily basis, and
yes, yeah,
I kind of spread pretty far and wide. And
yeah,
yeah,
good.
There are the people that are very much, this has gone too far, we need to cut this off completely. They're kind of in the extreme minority.
Yeah, I think so. It's very difficult, because you'll kind of go into some little pond where there's, you know, kind of these creatures, and it'll sound like that's the whole world for the 10 minutes that you're there. But then you go somewhere else and there's a million people who are saying you're doing fine, you know.
Yeah, and there's also, you know, I kind of think that the majority of people, like it's been, what, 40, 60, almost 70 years since, you know, trans medicine in the modern era. The average person has kind of accepted that this exists and is not really passionate one way or the other, you know, pro or you know what I mean? They're not really going to go out of their way one way or the other. And there are also the generations of trans and gay people that have come before, you know, the crew that are here, that are around now, have done a really good job in, you know, kind of normalizing, and we're just normal people. And, you know, like I've been out for the last 20 years, pretty much, you know, everybody that has met me on a work basis or a friendship basis has absolutely known that that I'm trans. Like, I kind of think that you know, while things are really ugly and there are a lot of people that are kind of advocating because they're really angry and they've had a lot of really ugly interchanges with, you know, with typically trans rights activists who aren't even trans.
Well, exactly, yeah.
They seem to be advocating from a place of anger that is a little bit revengey, but we also live in a populist era where I just don't think, you know, America is a different kettle of fish. Florida is quite scary. But I kind of think, you know, the rest of the Western world is pretty moderate, and most people are pretty live and let live, and they may not understand, but I don't think that they're, you know, pitchforks going to be happening anytime soon, like on this.
Well, no, I hope not. Although there are moves in Parliament, but then I suppose you always hear the high profile dozen people, you know, who want to put something across and, you know, protect women from trans people and stuff like this. But I mean, I'd be all for a slight tightening of the Gender Recognition Act because it kind of opened the door to allowing anybody to be anything. Merely by claiming, and but I don't know how. I mean, I see a lot of people in my you know, kind of social echo chamber who are kind of, you know, freaking out at what's happening at the moment with MPs talking about these kind of, you know, safeguarding for women and stuff. But I mean, it's important. I kind of don't like having to do it. I mean, people I know in my private life know that I'm trans. I don't like kind of getting out there too much on social media because of the personal kind of, you know, vitriol that it invites. But you kind of have to do it, don't you? You know, because otherwise they will advance, and you have to demonstrate that there is some, you know, reality, and that you're not just some, you know, green-haired person, you know, hiding behind an avatar. So, and I kind of, in one sense, I hate the thought of trans visibility, you know, because we've been kind of, you know, going on in the background quietly, you know, since the 1950s or even earlier, perhaps. But then we are in that position where you have to kind of stand by your colours, I suppose. Otherwise, you know, things could get worse. And I think that showing that you are just an ordinary, reasonable person is a really big, important part of this, which is why I partly make my argument case on, you know, this philosophical theory of the whole person. You know, you shouldn't be sheerly identified by one character. You know, it's one characteristic of your body, you know, you have to assess the whole person. So this is where, you know, getting back to these people that we started talking about, they're not looking at the whole person. They're looking at one
Aspect.
isolated aspect.
Yeah, so I kind of think the more people even the most rabidly, you know, like officially anti-trans activist, like Christian right wing people that I have been interacting with, when they're kind of faced with people who are reasonable and willing to negotiate and, you know, willing to come to the table, they that like basically they just want some safeguards, some like the sports situation sorted out, kids safeguarding to the wild, like to the wazoo, basically. So, you know, until you get to 17 or 18, like, you know, not really much is going to happen. Did I say prisons, you know, sports, and like once they get those sorts of things in place, then, you know, it's a different
I mean,
ball.
I think it is, yes. And I think that I think the sports and prisons thing is what largely have caused it to become so heated, because these are such obvious abuses, that you can't but wonder how on earth, you know, these things came to be in the first place. You know, people just, I suppose, you know, officials thinking that they're, you know, being politically correct. You know, political correctness is this kind of mimetic mind virus that has, you know, infected the Western world for the last 30 years. And I think people just get stuck in these, you know, kind of mindsets where they're just too afraid to question things or just to probe more deeply because, just any kind of questioning is kind of considered politically incorrect, you know, whether it be about any different subject about which is, you know, topical or controversial.
Yeah, I kind of go a little bit even further. I think that they like it hasn't really occurred to them to it like to occur to them to think about it. Like I think that they just don't. I think they're so busy seeing this bit that they haven't that thinking that this is they're being nice. They're being inclusive. They're being kind to trans women. They don't really
Yeah.
think about, oh, hold on a minute, what does it mean over here? Like, this bit is just missing.
Yeah.
Which is what the Jamie Reid interview was really interesting for, because it kind of demonstrates her realizing that this bit exists, and just kind of like at one point she's like, you know, like, I'm still deprogrammed in the interview with the guy. She's like, I'm still deprogramming my own thinking because I've been over here for so long that over here is actually new ground. Like, it's a revelation, which is like, oh my God, that's
yeah. I shall have to check that out. That sounds really absolutely excellent. I mean, I think there is, I think one of the tasks we have at the moment is joining up the dots between the different, you know, kind of questioning mindsets, you know, because the, you know, the Helen Joyces and the like, they seem to have their foot in the big media. And it's more difficult to get in as an outsider. But if we can kind of, you know, establish just amongst ourselves that there are people, you know, that we're not alone, basically. I mean, that's the first step, isn't it?
Yeah.
So.
Anyway, I shall let you go.
Yes, that's a good point to end.
Yeah. Thank you so much for doing this.
Well, thank you very much, for Kev. I'm really grateful. And we finally made it, and I look forward to doing it again.